you might be surprised why I, as an engineer who's doing management, I'm talking about language. I could tackle this in two ways. One would be an essentialist argument that language is required for all communication. But my reasons happen to be more earthly. Language is a part of my identity. Now the question arises, why do we need to protect languages? Language is a repository of the continuous knowledge of entire civilizations expressed. This doesn't mean it is static. In fact, it's more like a river, taking it all in, but flowing forever into the sea of human learning. When we lose a language, we lose this entire body of language, and associated with it, a culture, customs, and ways of expression. Now I'd like to ask you a question. Would there be lots of languages in sparsely populated countries with scattered populations, or densely populated ones where everyone lives close together? I think most of you would say the former, because when there are a lot of population in a small area, people will tend to have the same languages. And in scattered populations, since people live far away and rarely communicate with each other, they'll have different languages. But answer is actually the opposite. We find that the areas which have densely populated regions, they have the maximum languages. It's because each group wants to form its own identity, and language is the main part of identity. I think by this I have proved how important language is for identity. So in places like Indonesia, India, and Nepal, we see languages change every few kilometers. Now this proves two things. Protecting Indian languages is a large part of the project to protect the world's languages, since India has 445 languages and over 44% of them are endangered. And also that language is as important as a source of identity as a mode of communication. This is in line with the general trend in South Asia. Now we'll talk about the nature of language. Language is a unique public resource. It can sustain itself only if a community speaks it, for which a necessary condition is that it must be able to derive benefits from it. In fact, unlike all other natural resources, its existence is to the extent of its usage. Thus, equating language with ecology is ontologically wrong. It is well established a necessary condition for the life of a language is a community of speakers. Now, if we look at the reasons that ensure this, we would find that for a language to have a community of speakers, it is imperative that it is economically beneficial for them. I hesitate to take a Marxist position here, as that would privilege class over all analytical methods. A popular economic argument against language diversity has been that multiple languages lead to increased documentation and inconsistent implementation of policy, leading to the lower Human Development Index. This question has been actually dealt with very interestingly in a research paper by Sri Kumar in 2014. However, he found that the correlation between HDI and language diversity has been weak, with certainly no evidence of a negative correlation. The argument that has been followed in India to argue for Hindi as a common language is this. The economic argument is thus defunct. This would be a blow to our policymakers who continue to privilege one language, striking a death blow to others. Now the question comes on to what should be the procedure for language justice and how to protect our languages. One solution would be to have a bilingual policy with English and the local language. In this, the local language must not only be the dominant state language but also the smaller languages. But who will bear the cost of such a policy? Again, the answer comes from several research papers. There appear to be two main solutions outlined in them. In cases such as India, where the endangerment seems to be from the deliberate policy measures, the hegemonic language must bear the entire cost. However, if the causes of loss are natural, they may be borne by both communities of speakers. There have also been suggestions that in countries with a very high linguistic diversity, the government should choose a cost-effective solution based on other factors like social, political, and economic arguments. This is argued by Patton in 2001. Even this argument would be against any Indian language being given a hegemonic position, as from a social view, since Indian languages have inherent biases with respect to caste and gender, they stand disqualified. Also, is the political unfairness in privileging one community of speakers over others? Only a non-Indian languages like English can satisfy these conditions. Alternatively, we could also develop a language like Esperanto, which the European Union has adopted. The basis of all argument for language diversity is based on the assumption that language has intrinsic value. It's not merely instrumental, and the right is socially instead of individually defined. I happen to follow this view and do not believe it is merely an aspect of human capital as a means to achieve some higher ends. Thus, I would like to conclude by saying that languages are distilled civilization, which get better with age. To preserve the sweet drunkenness of beauty, we must protect them for further generations. Perhaps what is most needed is a forum for the equitable exchange amongst languages, so that each can enrich and contribute to each other.